Good afternoon. Thank you so much for having me here today. I want to start by talking about a virus. Not that one. This is a good news story for 2020, which I think we all need right now. And it's an amazing story. You probably haven't heard. In Dublin, just a couple of weeks ago, a little one-year-old girl called Olivia, Livy, was given a newly approved gene therapy to treat a rare condition. Children with this condition rarely survive past the age of two, but with this marvelous medicine, she'll be given the chance of a normal life. Her parents raised over €1 million to get her that treatment. It's amazing technology that was delivered by a wonderful team at St. James's Hospital and Children's Health Ireland. And it's one that's administered to the patient by a virus whose genes have been modified by science. So it's a technology that's had a rocky road when it comes to public perception and acceptance, genetic engineering. It's one that people fear, talked about by some using terms like designer babies and Frankenstein foods. Because they were the first genetically modified products that appeared on the market, much of the early debate about this technology centered on food. Genetically modified food, or GM food, is produced when the genetic material of a plant or animal has been manipulated to produce a genetically modified organism, or GMO. The original science was developed in the early 1970s, and the first animal with extra genetic material in its genome was born in 1974. In 1992, remember that year, the first commercial GM crop was introduced in China, an antibiotic-resistant tobacco plant. The first GM food was the famous Flavor Saver tomato that was engineered to have a longer shelf life than normal tomatoes and was approved for release in 1994. The use of genetic engineering in food has been met in many parts of the world with strong resistance over the last 25 years. Concerns raised include the mixing of genetically modified and non-genetically modified strains, the potential effects of GMOs on the environment, lack of confidence in regulation, and potential control of the food chain by private companies. In many parts of the world, experimental crops were destroyed, and highly stringent legislation has been brought in to ban or tightly control the use of GMOs. The EU, and Ireland in particular, has one of the strictest regimes. The government here has prohibited commercial cultivation of GM crops. But opposition to GM technology has been gradually decreasing among the public in recent years. And an overwhelming majority of scientists believe that it can be safely used and may in fact be critical to create a sustainable food chain in the face of globalization, antibiotic resistance, climate change, and agricultural pollution. We simply can't breed plants quickly enough to adapt, and many of our current farming methods are just too damaging. The Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation supports the use of GMOs in agricultural development, and in June 2016, 107 Nobel laureates signed a letter urging Greenpeace and its supporters to abandon their campaign against GMOs. And as Livy's story shows us, there are now huge possibilities to use GM technology for new therapeutics and personalized medicine, as long as there is the social license and appropriate regulation to deploy them. And at the moment, we don't have good consensus on either of those. So genetic technologies are simply being held back. Another equally powerful technology has had a very different road with the public. The internet. Many of you will know that that original internet was created in the 1960s, but it only became accessible to commercial activities in, yes, you guessed it, 1992, when companies like Netscape and AltaVista started, the same year the GM tobacco was launched. In the late 90s, internet technologies were being widely adopted. We had the start of the dot-com bubble, the dawn of Google, and widespread use of file sharing apps like Napster. Much of the public discourse related to things like copyright, freedom to access, and payment models for internet services. As those companies grew, there were debates about their inherent value, particularly when assessed alongside their very high stock price valuations. But in general, their products were seen as helpful, fun, innovative, and having massive potential to connect people, to open up access to information, and to create new business models. And they have. Underpinned by advances in data storage and analytics, machine learning, telecommunications, and artificial intelligence. But then we all started to notice that that ad for slippers that we'd searched for started to follow us from website to website. And we started to have concerns about privacy, about our data being the product that was being sold by the companies. Are our devices spying on us? The debate about echo chambers and targeted content and their impacts on democracy are now in the mainstream. But the technology was completely embedded in our lives before we had a chance to really consider the repercussions, either positive or negative. Today, researchers, journalists, policymakers, even some that work in the sector, are sounding alarms about the concentration of data, power, and influence in the hands of a few powerful actors, and talking about the need for guidelines and regulations, neither of which are straightforward now, as we can see when we try to use fairly blunt instruments like data protection legislation to regain control. So while GM technology was initially feared and catastrophized, and for many years the internet got a free pass, why have those two technologies been viewed so differently by the public and the mainstream media? Both can potentially bring great benefits, and both clearly have the potential to be harmful. And looking back, it seems that neither treatment was optimum. One certainly needed more scrutiny, and the discussion about the other was so polarized, it became impassable. If there had been more thoughtful, inclusive discussion about the ramifications of these technologies, both good and bad, as they were being developed, I wonder if both technologies today would be in a better place. For example, in Ireland, where we've had a lot of caution about genetics, apprehension about potential misuse of genetic information was one factor that prevented researchers from collecting biological samples from children involved in the Growing Up in Ireland study. This huge longitudinal study has been following the progress of nearly 20,000 children for over 15 years. And alongside all of the important information that's been collected, we have no genetic data. This is a missed opportunity. If we got ahead of the debate around the digital age of consent and smartphones, would we really have decided to give young teenagers full access to the web? Interestingly, a solution, the answer, might be right in front of us. One impact of the pandemic is that we have unprecedented levels of public interest and engagement with the science of an issue, with the innovation that's going on to try and provide a vaccine and treatments, because it's a fast-moving situation and it's directly impacting on all of our lives. I hear members of the public ringing into radio programs asking really insightful questions about the latest scientific research on COVID-19. The public are on the journey with the researchers. Of course, most developments in science are not scrutinized in real time and so closely. Most research is incremental, gradually building up a body of knowledge, which is then transferred into new products and policies, and it seeps into our lives almost silently. You know, we don't think too much about the science behind lifestyle advice like coffee's good for you, then not good for you. You know, it's great. We can pause and rewind live TV, or, you know, what's the algorithm behind a new dating app? We're consumers, end users, often passive recipients, and we often don't even hear about a technology until it's a finished product. How could we change that? Of course, and you might say I would say that, but properly funded public research is absolutely critical if we really want society to shape the technology that will in turn shape it. While many companies are moving towards more open innovation models, publicly funded researchers deliver for the citizen. And we can ask them to engage with the public from the very early stages of a new discovery. Many research funders now ask scientists to solve very particular problems through challenge funding. At the moment, Science Foundation Ireland is supporting teams that are developing innovations like non-addictive pain medication or novel ways to take carbon out of the atmosphere. And there's at least one non-scientist in every team. We're also supporting academic researchers to do placements within government departments and agencies, where they can help public servants and policymakers get to grips with things like the economic, social, and ethical impacts of blockchain in public services or drones, or the use of artificial intelligence in the judicial system. All of these, I think, are really positive initiatives and steps in the right direction. But what if we could do even more? Let's go back to the time when the most controversial thing that anyone posted on Facebook was, "It's complicated," and when Dolly the cloned sheep was making headlines. Let's gather together a diverse group of people, politicians, journalists, artists, lawyers, ethicists, writers, people of different ages and backgrounds. Let's get the researchers and the companies to explain what their technology can do and consider what it might be able to do in the future. But then, let the broader group think about the implications and consider what we need to do as a society to ensure that we get the benefits of progress but minimize the negative. Let's consider together whether we need to put education, guidance, or controls in place. You might be thinking that it's impossible to predict the future, you know, that we have no idea where these technologies might go. I mean, when Tim Berners-Lee published the first web page, you know, could he have imagined in his wildest dreams that in 2020 there would be nearly 2 billion web pages, with a quarter of them dedicated to cat videos? But, you know, journalists, artists, and writers are often the people who ask the uncomfortable questions about new science. David Bowie predicted much of what came to pass with the internet, calling it exhilarating and terrifying in 1990. Writers like Kazuo Ishiguro, Margaret Atwood, and William Gibson all tackled issues like human cloning, gene editing, cashless societies, and avatars years ago. And Terry Pratchett talked about fake news in the mid-1990s. And there have also been many groups of scientists who have agreed to put in place voluntary ethical codes for the areas in which they work. So I don't buy into the idea that it's not possible to imagine the issues that new technologies might bring. I believe that we should create a framework to bring those prescient ideas from science fiction, from literary fiction and the arts, to policymakers and wider society. Of course, we can and should do this for the technologies that are already here. But more importantly, we should start considering the consequences of future technologies before we get into polarized debates, or before we accept something without due consideration. How would we like to deal with the effects of Bitcoin mining on our energy system? What possibilities will the immense power of quantum computing unleash? How would we govern a settlement on the moon? And one that I think a lot about, what will we do when we all have copies of our own genome? Many of us will. It now only costs about €250 to sequence, but future humans certainly will. Will they be equipped to deal with the many issues that stem from that? Is our health system, our legislation? Researchers in Ireland, Professor Jane Souter and David Farrell, have designed and pioneered the citizens' assembly process, which brings together people for deliberative, thoughtful discussion, supported by experts. It helps identify consensus, especially for difficult and polarizing issues. I'm so delighted, that Jane and the ADAPT Research Centre at Dublin City University are being supported by Science Foundation Ireland to run a special citizens' assembly during Science Week, the second week of November this year. The platform that they are creating will give everyone a chance to give their views on life during and after the COVID-19 pandemic. How do we want to live? What will our cities be like? What role do we want technology to play in our lives? What matters? And that information will be fed back to elected representatives and policymakers. Why couldn't we use that same model to involve us all more in the discussions about technologies that will shape all of our futures? A recent report by the World Economic Forum recognizes that for future innovation to flourish, there will need to be clear market standards in place, appropriate legal frameworks, sustainability, and critically, alignment with societal values. So it makes good economic sense for research and innovation to progress in tandem with inclusive dialogue and critical appraisal. Giving people more of a say in their future is clearly the right and democratic thing to do. And it might just make for better science as well. Thank you.